Hi everyone, welcome to the next in our series of Church at Home videos. I'm Reverend Matt Malins, Vicar of St Luke's and St Paul's, and it's great for you to join us. As you can see, I'm in the holiday spirit. I'm getting ready for going away for the next couple of weeks, so the videos might look a bit different over the next couple of weeks. But I will be bringing you next week's sermon by the magic of video editing. There we go. As usual, we celebrate birthdays, and we're going to do that this morning. We have one to celebrate, and that's you, Katie Vaughan. So, Katie, here's your birthday biscuit. Catch.
I like watching how people
are. Thanks, Matt.
Wonderful. So, as we begin, Jerry's away, so I've had to do a bit more of the music. Apologies for that. But let's start with a prayer. Heavenly Father, I thank you for this glorious weather, and I thank you, Lord, that we can worship together via the internet. Lord, I pray that you bless us this morning. Bless us as we join together and as we worship you. In Jesus' name, amen. So we're going to start with an old song from Jerry, and then we're going to carry on worshiping.
Thank you.
Gideon, a brave and mighty man. Gideon, God whispered. Oh, Gideon, God called. I need your help, you brave and mighty man. But Gideon was nowhere to be found. As a matter of fact, he was hiding in a pit his father used for crushing grapes. You can't be talking to me, stammered Gideon. I'm no brave and mighty man. But God knew what he was doing. He always does. You're the man, all right, God said. The Midianites have my people surrounded, and I want you to round up an army to stop them. Gideon did what God told him, and to his surprise, over 30,000 men agreed to join him. Gideon, God whispered. Oh, Gideon, God called. You have far too many men. I want you to send some of them away. There are more Midianites than I can count, Gideon stammered. I need all the help I can get. But God knew what he was doing. He always does. I am the help you need, God said. So tell the men who are frightened to go home. Gideon did what God told him, and when he had finished, there were only 10,000 men left. Gideon. Oh, Gideon, God called. You still have too many men. Here's what I want you to do. Gideon listened to God's plan. Gideon stammered and shook, and then he led his men to the river and told them to have a drink. Some soldiers lapped up the water like dogs. Gideon sent them home. Others got down on their knees and scooped up the water in their hands. And when he had finished there were only 300 left. Gideon, God whispered. Oh, Gideon, God called. Now we are ready to fight the Midianites. But there are thousands of them, Gideon stammered, and only 300 of us. How can we possibly win? You can't, said God. Not without my help. And that's what I want you to see. Now listen, here's my plan. Later that night, Gideon led his 300 men to the edge of the Midianite camp. In one hand, every soldier carried a trumpet, and in the other hand, an earthenware pot with a flaming torch inside. There wasn't a sword in sight. At Gideon's signal, the soldiers blew their trumpets, smashed their pots, and shouted, "For the Lord and for Gideon!" The Midianite soldiers awoke, startled. It seemed as if there was a noise and fire all around them. Dazed and confused, they stumbled about in the dark, into each other, over each other, and it wasn't long before they were fighting each other too. When all the fighting had stopped, the Midianite soldiers who were left ran away, convinced that they had been defeated by some great army. But it was only Gideon and his 300 men and God who knew what he was doing all along.
You know, it's great to revisit some of these characters from the Bible. When I looked at the rotor and saw that I was talking about Gideon, I had that moment of, oh, which one's he? Who's he? And I thought, well, I know about the Gideon's Bibles, but, you know, I don't remember a tale about somebody, you know, leaving Bibles in Egyptian hotels or something. And then obviously read the story. And wow, what a lot we can learn from what such a brave and obedient man. I was really struck by the similarities of David and Goliath, where God used David, a young boy with no armour, no weapons, no military training, to defeat the mighty, fearsome foe of Goliath. You know, and there's those words in Corinthians that says that God uses those that the world see as foolish to confuse the wise. And just as David, a young, untrained boy, overthrew Goliath, we have this account of Gideon, a scared, vulnerable man, stripped of his army and his weapons and everything, still being obedient in the face of his vulnerability and giving God the glory for his defeat of the Midianites. You know, God uses the foolish to confound the wise. It's a bit like God choosing a nerdy IT guy and asking him to be the vicar of St. Luke's and St. Paul's churches. You know, there are some things that you can't prepare for, aren't there? Sometimes we're in uncharted territory. Sometimes we get news that just changes life as we know it. Or we're living in just strange pandemic times. It's hard, isn't it? We've got no control. We can't fix things. But God goes before us. You know, we might be feeling uncertain and worried and vulnerable. But God asks us to be obedient. Just like Gideon, he hid from God and he was scared. And he was saying, oh, no, 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 you don't mean me. You don't mean me. And yet, through his vulnerability and his fear, he was still obedient. Do you know, that's so encouraging. That is so encouraging. You know, it's easy to be obedient if we've got the 5-point plan, isn't it? If we can see what the goal is and we've sat down and discussed how we're going to get there and everybody has agreed and all of the parts are in place and we've got everything we need, you know, that's easy obedience, isn't it? But how much harder is it when we can't prepare? When everything changes and we can't prepare, and yet we hear God say, trust me. You know, this is a real message for our times. Everything's in flux. You know, Gideon had nothing he should have had for that encounter. You know, God cut down his army to 300 men. He had no weapons. He had no time to train. He had nothing. He went into battle against a mighty army with trumpets and torches. Who does that? Who does that? But God was prepared, and God knew. You know, it's easy for, you know, it's easy to say, oh, but you know, God, I will do that thing. I will, you know, if only, dot, dot, dot. But God says, trust me. Trust me. You know, I'm quite a prepper. That's just who I am. You know, I get up in the morning and, you know, if I fancy a treat, I need to earn it with doing the housework and stuff like that first. You know, I have goals in my head. It's how I work through the day and it works for me. You know, and Gideon could have been that person too. And I'm sure if he had thought about it, he could have come out with a whole list of stuff that needed to be achieved before he went anywhere near the Midianites' army. But, you know, God called him to be obedient, to listen and to step out. You know, it's not wrong to be prepared, but we need to recognise that sometimes we're in a state of no man's land. We've got no direction, no control, no answers. But God still calls us in those times. He still longs for us to hear him and meet with him. You know, we're really good at procrastinating, aren't we? You know, we'll put something on the agenda and we'll debate it and we'll reschedule, or maybe we'll think about it after the summer because no changes happen during the summer. Nobody, you know, we're so busy identifying and planning for X, Y, Z that we're missing the point that we should be doing A. You know, and as a church, we're really good at that, aren't we? Here's what we should do. So let's put it on the DCC agenda and then let's look at, well, we haven't got the money in the budget this year, or, well, we'll have to ask for faculty for that, and you know how hard that is, and all of this stuff. You know, God didn't allow Gideon the time to go through all this stuff, did he? He just said, trust me, I am enough. You know, and it's the same in life. If there's something we know we should be doing, it's really easy to be, oh, but we'll do it when our health is better, or our finances are better, or when we've retired, or when the kids have grown up, or when we've got, you know, we really need a new car, let's get that sorted, or, you know, but God is saying, no, for my glory, trust me now, today. God is challenging us to be responsive to him. You know, it doesn't say in the story that we've heard from the Lion Storyteller Bible, but if you read the full account of Gideon in the book of Judges, it's really interesting because Gideon was an Israelite and he was leading the army of the Israelites to defeat the Midianites. And after that spectacular victory, you know, the Israelites turned to Gideon and said, do you know what, you rock, can you be our king? And Gideon turns around and goes, no, I won't be your king. My son will not be your king. He comes back with this. It is God who leads us. You know, doesn't that speak of such character? Isn't that just wonderful of Gideon? That whole success in victory, and he just points it all to God. It's for God's glory. You know, he recognises that it was God who won that battle. It's quite obvious, really. 300 men, valiant men, with torches and trumpets. It was clearly God's victory. Clearly God's victory. But it was all for God. All for God. Gideon just wanted to point all the glory back to him. And he turned down the chance to have self-glory and self-gratification. Because he knew that it is God's glory. You know, it's all for Jesus. God uses the foolish or the weak to just confound the wise. Had it been a massive, well-trained, well-equipped army that had overthrown the Midianites, then that would have been a great military victory, wouldn't it? But as it happened, the way it came about, it was a great God victory because of Gideon's obedience in the face of vulnerability and fear. So, you know, when we're feeling scared and unprepared, it's our opportunity to do something for God's glory. You know, and that's what I want for me in my life. I want my life to point to God's glory. one of my favourite images for that is a film that I love. It's quite an old one called The Mummy, and it shows them using a big brass bowl inside the pyramids to redirect the light from a little window in the side of the pyramid, redirect the light into the darkest corners. You know, and my prayer is that us as individuals and as a church, it will be for us all about pointing people to the light and to the glory of God. You know, we stand behind that brass bowl and we point the glory of God into the darkness of the world and we connect the two. It's all about God. It's all for his glory. You know, hiding is a solid option. That's what Gideon did at first, understandably. He hid. That didn't make him less of a man. God still used his vulnerability and his humanity. But how much more happens when we say, when Gideon said, "Yes, God, I can trust you, even in a foreign land, even with this news that I've had that's just put my life on hold, even in a pandemic world where I've got no control, even when I'm scared, when I'm vulnerable, when I'm ill, when I'm so cross with myself, I can trust you. I see you." You know, and God calls us to him, and sometimes it's not to go out and overthrow armies. Sometimes we're just being called to find him. Just to find him and that rock that we need. So I'm just really grateful for today's reading, for Gideon. And for the fact that in the face of all his vulnerability and worry and unpreparedness, that he listened and he was obedient. Amen.
Gideon knew what was needed to defeat the Midianites, a huge army. But God had another plan. God acted unexpectedly in that situation. He didn't do what anybody thought he was going to do. He didn't do what was needed. Anyone would have thought it was impossible what God was asking, but he knew what they needed to do. How would we cope with that? I know how I would. We often know what's needed in a situation, how a problem should be solved, how a prayer should be answered. But do we? Do we hinder what God does because we pray our solution into a situation? That solution that we think will work, that we know how it needs to be sorted. What I want you to do is to think of some situations that seem impossible, that you know how to solve. You might want to have a chat as a family about this if you're there with other people. And then we're going to pray about those. And afterwards, I'd like you to write them down and put them somewhere. And then come back to them in a few months or a year or even a few years and see actually how God solved that problem. You could pause this while you chat. Father God, we offer you all of these situations. We recognise that we all have our own ideas about how you should act, and we want to put them to one side and ask you to act as you think best. When you helped Gideon, it wasn't how anyone thought the Midianites would be defeated. Help us to trust you with all of these situations, and help us to be willing to play the part in the solutions that you need us to. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
The priest.
Well, I hope you've enjoyed joining us today, and thank you, Cathy, for what you've shared about Gideon. But let's close in prayer with the collect prayer for today. Almighty God, who sent your Holy Spirit to be the life and light of your church, open our hearts to the riches of your grace, that we may bring forth the fruit of the Spirit in love and joy and peace. So the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. And go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.